online. And I definitely make good use of your YouTube channel. So for anyone who hasn't checked it out, I encourage you to do that too. But let me just jump in because I've got a lot of stuff to cover today. Today, in the next hour, my aim is to show you that there is no contradiction between sustainable and profitable growth. So that quote is not me, someone who went and got a grad degree in peace studies, who's saying that. But that quote actually comes from Paul Polman, who's the CEO of Unilever. Yes, that huge multinational that has brands like Dove, Lipton, and Omo detergent. And so we're going to look at why he's saying there's no contradiction between sustainable and profitable growth. And I'm going to posit that business can be a powerful change agent for positive change. And this can be done without employee burnout, without losing market share, without adding extra costs to your business, and without scaling down. And we're going to go through a couple case studies that demonstrate this. I'm going to bust a few myths and give you a bit of a framework about how you can do this in your organization or your business. But before we do that, I just want to find out a little bit more about who is on the line with us. So Sarah, if you can queue up the first survey. I'm curious to know what gender you are, if you're male or female. So male, men type 1, women type 2.
Okay, so we'll just give you a few more seconds to vote. Almost all of you have done so. Okay, I'll close up the line. All right, so 25% of folks on the line today are male and 75% are female.
Okay, thank you. And so my next question is, in which area do you feel like your organization or your business has the most room for improvement? Convivial relationships amongst colleagues is number one. Number two is fair and equal treatment of all employees. Number three is sustainable environmental footprint or reducing your environmental footprint. Number four is equitable sourcing of inputs. If you're a service company, your inputs might include your office supplies and your computers and all that kind of stuff. And number five, a collaborative relationship with competitors.
All right, so people are voting a little bit more slowly here, so I'll give you some time.
I have a feeling that there might be some people who think that there's a couple of these areas and it's hard to pick just one.
Right. I should have made this a multiple response poll, but... Well, all right, almost everyone has voted, so I'll go ahead and close this out. Okay, so 18% of people on the line say convivial relationships amongst colleagues, 27% fair and equal treatment of all employees, 9% sustainable and environmental footprint, 18% equitable sourcing of inputs, and 27% collaborative relationships with competitors. So collaborative relationships and fair and equal treatment of employees are the most.
Okay. And it's interesting that we also have lots of women on the line, and I wonder if the women feel particularly passionate or bear the brunt of unfair and unequal treatment of employees. But that's, yeah, we'll that's a debate for another time. So let me tell you a little bit more about my story. Sarah already shared some stuff with you. So the first couple jobs that I had when I was in school were in fashion. I worked for a fashion magazine. I actually worked in Paris. And then I worked on Madison Avenue. And these were basically jobs that were totally devoid of meaning. And this on the left is my boss at the company that I work for on Madison Avenue, Lisa, who looks pretty cool. You can see that she's got dreadlocks and everything. And I learned a lot from her. But mostly I learned about the path I did not want to take. Because she, after she graduated from law school, she went straight into the corporate world. And after a dozen years of corporate law, totally burned out and kind of had a midlife or quarter life crisis And she decided that she wasn't going to do law anymore and was just going to do a job that she could do in her sleep, which turned out to be, she's an excellent saleswoman. So what she did was she sold advertising for financial publication to all her former colleagues in the corporate world. And she'd come in every morning that I was working for her. She would never come in at 9 a.m., rarely before noon, and would come hungover with crazy stories, would work for 90 minutes, do what she needed to do, and then was off on some other crazy adventure. And so my antidote to not ending up like Lisa was to get a master's degree in peace and conflict studies. The problem, though, was that I couldn't figure out how to make peace profitable. And as many of you know, going to university in the U.S. Puts you with most students with a significant amount of debt. And so pursuing something like peace and then not being able to make it profitable can be problematic. So what I ended up doing was that I worked for a high-end tutoring company in New York City, and I was able to work there for about 30 hours a week, which gave me enough money then to have plenty of time on the side to volunteer for various peace organizations. But what I'm trying to do now is to reconcile those two, because I really don't believe that doing meaningful and peaceful work ought to be incompatible with making a decent living. And so what I've done is a lot of research on how companies do it, and I'm sharing that info with you now. And so right now I'm building two brands, Peace is Sexy and the Peace Superheroes, as for-profit businesses. And we can talk a little bit about what the models that I'm using for that are during the Q&A if anyone's curious. So the first case study, which I think is a great case study, is Unilever, because Unilever is a huge multinational company. They've got multiple brands across different sectors. And they, Paul Polman is able to say that there is no contradiction between sustainable and profitable growth, because a few years ago they started the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan. And so what that includes, it includes targets that they want to achieve by 2020 in terms of environmental impact, in terms of health and well-being, and in terms of enhanced livelihood. So you notice that even though it's sustainable living, environment is just one component of it. Because I think what we're starting to see more and more is a larger definition of sustainability, which includes social aspects, cultural aspects, community well-being aspects. And I think that's reflected in the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan. And so Paul Pullman has noted that the brands, the Unilever brands that have integrated this USLP, which include Lifebuoy, Dove, Comfort One Rinse, Purit, they're all growing by double digits, which is above the company average. So once again, no contradiction between sustainable and profitable growth. The second case study is actually from the boutique tutoring company that I worked at. I'm going to try and give you examples kind of from the big corporate world, and then smaller organizations, because I know we have people on the line with us that come from a variety of sectors. And so in the tutoring company that we worked for, we did a lot of pro bono work. Specifically, we worked with Cristo Rey High School, and we did SAT tutoring for students from Cristo Rey High School. For those of you who don't know about Cristo Rey, it's also a Jesuit education system, and it's a network of schools, and it's really innovative. And the way they operate is that they have high schools specifically for low-income students. And so in almost every case, these students are the first ones that are going to go off to college in their families. And in some cases, they're the first ones to have graduated high school. And so these are low-income students, and they're in the high school 4 days a week. The fifth day, they're working in a company. And the company, instead of paying the student's salary, pays what the salary would be to the school. And that's how they cover their operating costs. And so not only are these students getting kind of college prep-oriented education, they are also getting exposure in jobs and in companies where they would have never even dreamed of having access to before, because they're working for lawyers, they're working in financial institutions, they're working in media companies, hospitals, and even though they're entry-level jobs, it's nothing that's in their world. Their parents certainly don't work in these environments, and so it's really innovative. So what we did was we offered SAT test prep for them. And I taught a couple classes at Cristo Rey. And I'll tell you that trying to get a room full of high school students interested in an exam that they don't even necessarily understand what the implications of it are, and getting them motivated to do well on this exam. And these were not the students that I was usually working for, who were very privileged students, who were in New York City's top high schools, who were expecting to get into places like Georgetown and Harvard and whatever else, who would be hanging on my every word because their goal was to move their verbal score from a 710 to a 750 or a 760. The Cristo Rey students had a much lower starting point and were perhaps not as motivated. And I'll tell you that working with the Cristo Rey high school students certainly taught me a lot about engaging with students, about getting people motivated, and really just made me a better tutor for my other students. The other pro bono work that we did at this tutoring company was that we worked with scholarship students at top high schools. And so this was kind of the CSR, Corporate Social Responsibility Initiative, that we had at that tutoring company. And all these things give the current tutors skills to work with their high-paying clients, too. So now let's look at a couple myths. The first myth is, now that we're starting to talk a lot about corporate social responsibility, there's kind of this trend to say, well, all companies need a CSR department. And I actually don't think so. So let me explain to you a little bit about the history of corporate social responsibility. The first wave of it was corporate philanthropy, which is totally out now. Corporate philanthropy, you might be familiar with the Rockefeller Foundation or the Carnegie Foundation. So these big corporations that were very successful, and then they created a philanthropic branch, basically a charity branch that was outside of the corporation with the money and the profits from the corporation. A lot of these are set up as endowments, and so they kind of are meant to perpetuate till eternity. So the first phase of that was the philanthropy lives outside of the company. The next phase of that was creating corporate social responsibility departments. There were different terms for that. Or having a person dedicated within a company to corporate social responsibility. That model is also phasing out. So basically, it's moving the philanthropy or moving the corporate social responsibility into the company, but having it as a separate silo, as a separate department. And that is also getting phased out, or is kind of the what's going on mostly now, but is not what we're on the cutting edge of. And so what the forward-looking companies are doing is they have what Michael Porter, who's a Harvard Business School professor, calls what he calls a shared value philosophy. And this is what we're looking at now. And so what shared value means is that they're incorporating values throughout the company, not as a separate department. They're reviewing practices company-wide in terms of employee well-being, clean supply chains, community engagement, etc. And it really addresses business needs in conjunction with social needs and environmental needs. And all these things are being taken into account concurrently. And so what that means is that companies are actually shifting their product focus. So, for example, Nike, instead of just selling sneakers, is actually selling health. IBM, instead of just selling computers, is selling smart cities. Dove, instead of selling beauty products, is selling inner beauty. So really, we've moved from a doing good is outside the company to doing good is inside the company, but a separate section, to doing good kind of permeates the whole company. And I think that's really excited, and that's really where business can be a force for good. Myth number two is that marketing and sales necessarily involve at least a little bit of duping the client. And I think that happens in many ways. It happens probably, you know, the classic way is you sign up for something and you think it's a one-time fee, and then it turns out you've actually, it's been a subscription, and you didn't realize that you were signing up for a subscription and you were getting charged every month for it. Or you sign up for something, or you buy something, and you didn't read all the fine print, because who does? And so in addition to the amount that you have to pay, there's also an extra sign-up fee, and there's also an insurance fee, and there's also a membership fee, and a setup fee, and whatever. And so you end up paying a lot more than what you thought you'd have to. And so that is also a model which I think is getting out of fashion, and getting out of fashion fast. What's replacing it is heart-centered marketing. So I've seen this a lot in the kind of amongst more holistic businesses or holistic practitioners, and it's really value-based. And it's based on integrity, total integrity of the person, the seller, and total integrity of the buyer. There's, I think we're seeing also a lot more that transparency is much more valued. Part of that is because information is so easily accessible on the internet. And so you really have to be transparent in your sales and marketing if you're going to get clients, because, you know, if I, as a buyer, as a consumer, think that a product looks interesting but it looks too good to be true, or I'm sure unsure about it, I just go online and Google it and see what others have had to say. And so I can easily find out if others if this company is really representing itself as it claims to be. And I think consumers appreciate transparency much more, and it's become de rigueur. The other trend that we're seeing now also is conscious consumption. Sorry. And so this was probably best promulgated by Patagonia. And the idea of conscious consumption is actually really teaching consumers to consume what they need and not go beyond that. You might remember the advertising campaign that they put out on Black Friday a couple years ago, with the Patagonia jacket, and then the big headline that said, "Don't buy this jacket." And then underneath, they had a couple paragraphs explaining their philosophy of conscious consumption, about really focusing on reducing, and then reusing, and then recycling. And they had another R in there, which I can't, repurposing maybe. So Patagonia has been a big advocate of teaching consumers to only consume what they need. You might think that that would be contradictory, or that they'd be losing, losing profits on that. But it turns out the Patagonia has actually doubled operations and tripled its profits since 2008. Not just because of their conscious consumption, but I think that's part of it, because they've been able to attract a wider base of consumers who appreciate a company and who have the same values as Patagonia does around creating a sustainable place for all of us to live, a sustainable earth for all of us to live on. So kind of by specializing, they've gained more, not only consumers, but I think more fans. The next myth we're going to look at is that you can't collaborate with competitors. So this is actually something I think we're shifting away from. So collectively is a new cooperative, I guess I'd say, of a number of different multinational organizations, multinational companies. And it's a digital platform meant to engage millennials to take action on climate change. So the idea is they're coming together to address an issue that affects all of their businesses. And it includes Coca-Cola and Pepsi, arch rivals like Unilever and Nestle, global advertising groups like WPP and Omnicom. So why are these competitors coming together? Because they see climate change as an issue that affects all of them, and they want to engage with millennials, but probably not just millennials, to take collective action. We also saw a couple of years ago how a lot of the Silicon Valley companies, including the big ones like the Googles and Google, Facebook, Twitter, were all joining together around SOPA, around access to the internet, when that was being debated in Congress. So you're seeing more and more of these kind of collective action around specific issues. In the chocolate industry also, competitors, Cadbury's and Nestle, amongst others, have come together in order to ban child slavery in cacao harvesting. So we're starting to see more and more competing companies working together to solve issues that affect all of them. Then in the solopreneur and online coaching world, I've seen kind of a different type of collaboration in which these coaches, this group of coaches, actually refers clients to each other and promote, they cross-promote each other's programs. So they're all business coaches, but they kind of each have a different focus. And so the reason that they are able to not see each other as total competitors is because they've specialized. They either specialize their niche or they specialize their program. And so some of them work with women, some of them work with holistic practitioners, some of them help you design your sales funnel, others help you with the wording of your emails, of your marketing emails, others help you develop online events, others teach you how to run a seminar or a live event. And so all their coaching is actually complementary, and they understand that even though they might have a potential client on their email list, that client might not be ready for their program, and what will make them ready for their program is actually someone else's product. And so there's a lot of synergy, and a lot of these coaches are making 7 figures yearly. So clearly it's a model that's working for them. Now let's kind of go back to the framework that I want to teach, or get into the framework that I want to teach. And so let's go back to the title of this webinar, which is Peace is Profitable: Why Community and Collaboration Are Good for You, Your Business, and the World. Excuse me, let me take a drink of water here. So I define peace as the dynamic process of creating sustainable relationships with oneself, with other people, with other cultures, and with the earth itself. And you can kind of think of it as an onion, where you've got inner peace, and then interpersonal peace, international peace, and then interspecies peace, which is really just taking care of the environment, but it didn't start with an I. Interestingly, when I did a marketing survey for Peace is Sexy a couple months ago, and I asked people what they thought of the word peace, or what peace evoked for them, some people were totally into inner peace, and other people were talking about like the international peace and diplomacy and kind of big picture stuff. And then other people was, oh, how I get along with my family members, how I get along with my kids. And so we kind of have peace lives in all these spaces. And we kind of tend to affiliate ourselves with one of these definitions of peace, but it's pretty rare that we actually have a definition of peace or relate to peace as actually a thread that goes through all of these levels, from the inner to the international to the interspecies. And so this is actually something that they teach in peace studies, is that peace is works at all these levels. And so I think it's really interesting to think about peace in that way. And then, so to go to the second part of the title, why community and collaboration are good for you, your business, and the world, I think community can certainly help give you the space to find inner peace if you have a community that's supporting you. I think community and collaboration are key in interpersonal and international peace. And if we have an extended sense of community, you know, we can be in community with the environment and other species. And certainly for some people, that, you know, that's much more present than others. I think animal lovers really feel like they have a sense of community with animals. So that's a little bit of a few definitions. So now I'm going to take you through each of these layers: inner peace, interpersonal peace, international peace, and interspecies peace, and relate them to business and work. And so I'll give you a couple key points, and then in each of these I'm going to give you guiding questions to help structure your thinking around this, and really so you can start implementing these concepts of peace in your job and in your organization, in your office. So inner peace, and you know, at, and then parenthetically, despite work, because I think sometimes work can be very harrowing and we're pulling our hair out. And I have a feeling some of you might be wondering, well, how can I have inner peace at work? Like, that's not the space for it. You know, I'm not going to sit at my on my desk with my legs crossed meditating or whatever. But don't worry, this is not what that is. So part of what I think what we have to do is to redefine success to include well-being, meaning, and contribution, which to me are just other words for peace, for inner peace. And the person who makes a great case for this and who has done a ton of research is Arianna Huffington. If you check out her latest book, Thrive, it's all about this. So I think, especially in the U.S., we tend to define success a lot according to our paycheck and to our position. But then we end up with people who are totally burned out or totally unhappy with their lives because they're not taking into account well-being, meaning, and contribution. And so some of the things that you can do to help cultivate your inner peace is to take time to unplug, reboot, and rest. And so again, Arianna Huffington, she sleeps 7 to 8 hours every single night, even though she's the founder and CEO of an online newspaper, which you would think has a 24-hour news cycle, and so she's constantly working. Nope, she gets 8 hours of sleep every night. And the impact is that she, in her research, demonstrates that the more time you take to unplug, reboot, and rest, the more effective and productive you are. And she notes that high-profile figures who practice mindfulness or meditation include board chairman Bill Ford, LinkedIn CEO Jeff Weiner, Twitter co-founder Evan Williams, ABC host George Stephanopoulos, and the list goes on and on. And so I think part of the reason these people have become so successful is because they do take the time to recharge themselves. And so some guiding questions to help you focus on this. The first one is to think about what is truly important to me in my life. Is it really my job, or is my family important to me? Is my health important to me? Is my spirituality important? Is making a difference important to me? Just think about that. Then how can I connect my job to a larger purpose? At Joie de Vivre Boutique Hotels, I love this story, they did an exercise with the housekeeping staff about what their purpose is, and the housekeepers realized that just beyond cleaning and making the rooms look nice, what their real purpose was to be moms away from home for hotel guests. So if you think about that, if you're cleaning toilets and making beds, and that's just what you're doing, that's your job. But if you shift your purpose to being a mom away from home for the person that's staying in this room, I think, you know, those housekeepers must just have such a level of caring and compassion for guests that I can't even imagine. Kind of makes me want to go to stay in one of those hotels right now. And the last guiding question that I have is, what can I do? I'm sorry, what can I stop doing so I have less time on my devices and more time to rest? So for example, Padmasri Warrior, I hope I'm pronouncing her name right, she's the chief technology officer at Cisco, and she has a device-free day every Saturday all day. And she is the chief technology officer. So if she can do it, you can do it too. Or like I was joking with Sarah actually before we got on the line here, and I was saying that actually having a kid has made me so much more focused and effective and cut out a lot of my time on devices. So either elect to have a device-free day like Padmasri Warrior or get yourself a kid. No, it's a joke. The next layer is interpersonal peace. So we're going to look at interpersonal peace at the office and then outside the office. So the first key, I think, to interpersonal peace at the office is creating a sense of community with colleagues. Tony Hsieh and Zappos, Tony Hsieh is the head of Zappos, and they are kind of famous for the company culture that they have and the sense of community that they have there. You can read his book called Delivering Happiness to get a sense of how to build a company culture really with a strong community. Then there's equal and fair working conditions for all employees. That can go a long way in terms of creating a sense of interpersonal peace at the office. And then collaboration across departments. And so really what this means is shifting from valuing outcomes to shifting to valuing relationships, seeking perfection to seeking connection, going from validation, from seeking validation to offering validation, shifting away from transaction to trust and transformation. And it's kind of using these values to create a sense of community and collaboration. To be clear, by collaboration across departments, I don't mean start CCing everybody in other departments on your departmental-wide emails. I think that there is some level of collaboration that can be designed by creating certain initiatives and projects that necessarily bring different departments together to collaborate, but I also think that there's an element to be said for organic collaboration. So, for example, when I was at the tutoring company when I lived in New York, whenever I'd go into the office, I actually started the office up in Westchester, but whenever I'd come into the Manhattan office, I would just chat with everybody that was in there. Just to find out what was going on, and so I talked to the technology guy. I talked to him a lot because I kept breaking the system. But I talked to the curriculum developers, I talked to the office manager, the human resources person, and kind of in this chatting, you know, we'd always kind of discover something. Either they'd learn something about the problems that I was having and they'd have some suggestions, or I just learn more about their jobs, and so then in the future I would know to contact them when I had a specific issue. And just in those kind of informal chats, I think we solved a lot of problems. So some guiding questions to help you think about interpersonal peace at the office include, who can I build a stronger relationship with? Especially if you work in an office with lots of departments or in a company with lots of departments, I would encourage you to find someone in a different department to take out to lunch once a week, once a month, and really cultivate that relationship. Not necessarily so that you guys can collaborate on a specific project, but I think really to give you a more integrated view of the company. Or you could also decide that each week you're going to go out to lunch with someone different, just to learn more about how the company functions. I think in a lot of onboarding programs, new employees kind of get taken around to different departments, and they kind of get this holistic view of the company as much as you can get it in a couple days or a week or however long the onboarding program is. But then that tends to just kind of get phased out or forgotten. And people tend to operate in their departmental silos without knowledge or desire, really, to find out what's going on in other parts of the company. Another guiding question could be, how can I improve working conditions? I'd say certainly if you're a manager, this would be a key question in terms of thinking about equal and fair working conditions for all employees. But even if you're not a manager or you have no direct reports, I think that you can think about for yourself what would improved working conditions look like for me. And you can find allies. You can find your colleagues and peers and kind of discuss these ideas with them and then find the appropriate venue maybe to bring them up. The next section that we're going to look at is interpersonal peace out of the office. So looking at relationships with clients, I think one of the key places where companies either create clients for life or lose them for life is in their customer service. And I think you really can use some great interpersonal communication skills to really cultivate relationships with clients. I told a story in the last webinar about how I use nonviolent communication to connect with clients, because a lot of them, as you can imagine, at a touring company would call with a lot of anxiety about their child's SAT scores or math grades or history tests, and they had a lot of anxiety, and so they would go on and on and on trying to explain to me all the conditions that their child was going through and how the teacher was unfair and whatever and whatever. And once I started using nonviolent communication skills with these clients, I was able to get them to feel like they were heard really quickly and feel that like they were understood. And then instead of spending an hour on the phone basically doing therapy with a client or a potential client, I let them tell enough of their story, maybe for 10 or 15 minutes, got them to understand how we might be able to help and sign them on as a client. And so my time spent on the phone was quartered, and therefore I could get to a lot more clients. Relationships with suppliers, I think, are also really key. Instead of just looking at suppliers as obstacles in the running of your business, I think developing relationships with suppliers is really key, positive relationships. And so Zappos, again, is a really good example. I know that they have an annual event, just a party, where they invite all their suppliers. And so therefore, they've created really great relationships with their suppliers who let them know about the latest trends, let them know when certain things are going out of stock, and they've just actually been able to improve Zappos' business. Then we can also think about impact on community. And so, for example, in Colombia, the country, business is very concerned with human rights. So, for example, the German Development Agency worked with Coca-Cola Colombia on the reintegration of former prisoners. The Global Compact, which is kind of a UN compact or statement for businesses and how they can help in the achievement of the Millennium Development Goals. So the Global Compact Network in Colombia works with the Bogota Chamber of Commerce to promote the role of the private sector in building peace. And they do that through knowledge sharing, dialogue, promoting best practices, lessons learned, creating alliances and having all kinds of networking events. And so, once again, I think there is a role for business to have a positive impact on communities. Some guiding questions to think about how can I add value to my clients? I think everybody in business is hopefully thinking about that, but how can it be real, meaningful value, I guess is the question. How can I get my suppliers aligned with values that are important to my company? So I think Patagonia, again, has been working a lot with their suppliers in order to get them, their suppliers to be more green and have smaller environmental footprints. How can my company contribute sustainably to the community? So again, not just having a volunteer day where everybody in your office goes and helps paint a local school or does like a Habitat for Humanity kind of project, but also, what are the core competencies in your company, or what are core competencies that people have in your company, and how can they contribute in that area to people in the community? How can they improve really the livelihoods and situations of the people in the community? So I think that's really key to creating to having business as a force for good. International piece. I think a lot of people kind of might be scratching their heads about how business can have an impact on international piece. And so probably the clearest way is through supply chains. If you're a coffee shop or if you're involved in the food industry, there's a lot of talk in terms of supply chains and sourcing products. Fair trade is one way to make sure that products have a clean supply chain because it ensures that producers are receiving fair compensation, which means that they your coffee beans or your chocolate, your cacao is not harvested through forced labor or by child slavery. And for, in the case of fair trade, it also means that in many cases the community is benefiting through access to schools and health services. You can also choose to work with B corporations because that certification process covers a lot in terms of supply chain ethics and supply chain management. You may also want to become a B corporation. B stands for benefits or not only for profit corporation, in order to show your clients and other businesses that you have a certain standard in terms of your supply chains, but also all different ethical components of your business. Another way to think about international peace is connecting your work to a larger purpose. So for example, Henry Gifford, who's an engineer that I interviewed for Peace is Sexy, he says that he fights terrorism with a caulking gun because he makes buildings more energy efficient and therefore less dependent on foreign oil. So how is your work contributing to a larger purpose? So some guiding questions. Do I know where my inputs are coming from? How can I find out if I don't know? And then what have other companies in my sector done to clean up their supply chains? And how can I connect my work to something that's making a real contribution to the world? Now we can talk about environmental peace or interspecies peace. So focusing on environmental impact. Another certification you can look for in terms of environmental impact is the Rainforest Alliance, because anything that has their logo on it means that it comes from wood or a forestry product that was sustainably harvested. You can also think about the draining of resources and how much your business is draining resources. So some guiding questions are, can we use more Rainforest Alliance certified products? How can we minimize our environmental impact? So for example, you could get on board, your business could get on board with Patagonia's Conscious Consumption campaign or their Vote the Environment campaign. But there's also room for innovation, I think. So for example, Unilever is has innovated in terms of clothing detergent. And they've created clothing detergents, I think it's their Omo product line, which uses the short cycle in the washing machine. So instead of having your laundry go through an hour and a half cycle with the regular Omo formula, your clothes can come out just as clean in 30 minutes with their kind of environmentally sustainable clothing detergent, which if you think about then how many loads of laundry and how much water that consumes, that can have a really significant impact on the environment and saving water. And I'm actually just waiting for a computer and electronics company to create devices that are truly environmentally friendly, not just bamboo cases, but looking at all the components that can really be reused and effectively repurposed. Another thing to think about, another guiding question is, how can we cause environmental regeneration? So not just limiting our environmental impact, but actually how do we regenerate the environmental richness that we as the human species have already killed off. So a great example of this is using the principles of permaculture. And in New York, in some of the neighborhoods that were damaged by Hurricane Sandy, the kind of communities there have decided to adopt principles of permaculture. So not just rebuilding the community and kind of building dikes or whatever to stave off future hurricanes or bigger waves, but they're regenerating the environment in on that land, so that really nature is taking care of itself and protecting the land and the people that live there. And I can recommend Jeff Lawton's work if you're interested in permaculture. So I know that this might be a little bit overwhelming because I've covered a lot, you know, giving you really broad brush strokes in a lot of different areas, and you might be wondering why I'm giving you so much of the forest and giving you so many balls to juggle. And so part of it is I really think that this works best as an integrated approach, again, because if you go back to that onion of peace, peace works on all these levels, inner peace, interpersonal peace, international peace, and interspecies peace. And so probably one of the most famous peace builders in the world, Gandhi, once said, be the change you wish to see in the world. And I think that that really means connect your inner peace to the interpersonal peace, to the international peace, to the interspecies peace. Another argument for an integrated approach is that I think the segmented thinking is really what's gotten us into the mess we are now. And I think it's because we've kind of divided ourselves up. Our companies are divided up, our populations are divided up, that we don't see a holistic picture, and so that's why we don't necessarily see the impact of what we do. I mean, in economics, they call that externalities. And I think externalities, kind of in classic economic thinking, externalities are a lot of the source of environmental problems that we have now. And then finally, your business will function better if it's fully integrated. So your business's approach to peace should also be integrated. And from integration comes innovation, and I think that's where we can see a lot of breakthroughs in terms of making business a source of good. So I've given you a lot, and now I'm going to tell you how not to get started. So I would not create a separate CSR department. If we go back to that concept of shared value, we really want to be integrating these ideas throughout the company and throughout the organization. So you might want to have maybe some companies now have corporate social responsibility officer, a CSO, or corporate sustainability officer, I think they're calling them, a lot of companies are calling them. So someone who's at the C level who is kind of keeping track of this for the whole company, but do not create a separate CSR department, because again, we want to stay away from this siloed thinking. Do not read up on all the problems your organization might be creating or contributing to. I think I might have given you some food for thought. And I certainly hope that you're not like, oh, our environmental impact is horrendous. Oh, I don't know anything about our supply chain. You know, are we supporting child slavery or human trafficking? Don't start doing that. I think you're just going to end up totally depressed and overwhelmed with the magnitude of what you might find out. And definitely do not try to take everything on at once. I think that's another formula for overwhelm. So how you should get started and what I would recommend is pick one area which particularly speaks to you. Are you interested, or is the part of the presentation that spoke about inner peace what you jived with, interpersonal peace within the office, interpersonal peace outside the office, international peace, or interspecies peace? Pick whichever one spoke the most to you during the presentation. And then journal or write a memo answering at least one of the guiding questions that I gave you on that slide. You're all going to get this emailed to you, so don't worry about that. And then identify an easy, measurable action that you can take regularly, which will contribute to peace or sustainability in that area, and then start implementing it. And be honest with yourself about what kind of support you need to implement it. Do you need to find a buddy in your office that's going to hold you accountable? Do you need to put a reminder in your calendar to keep doing it? Do you need to get your boss on board? Do you need to work with a coach? But really think about the support that you need in order to implement this action. And then share your success and celebrate. So I know we're almost out of time. And I covered a lot. So if anyone has any questions, feel free to get in touch with me. You can drop me an email at contact@piecesexy.net. You can check out the website, a couple of resources that you might be interested in on Pieces Sexy. I do have a category called Pieces Profitable, and you'll find a bunch of articles there about the stuff that we talked about today. And you can sign up for newsletter updates on the website. They're up at the top. Or if you download the 16 easy shortcuts to a more balanced, happier, and saner life, not only will it help you get on the track to inner peace, but then you'll also be signed up for updates. And I can also recommend, there's actually a great online telesummit going on this week called the Enlightened Business Summit. And it is being hosted by the Shift Network. And there are some really amazing speakers on that, and I'll send Sarah the link to it that she can forward to you people, and you should be able to access the recordings. If you sign up today or tomorrow, then you should be able to access their recordings for free pretty easily. And some of you might also be interested in the Cone Communications blog, which is called Prove Your Purpose, which is a great resource for CSR and cause marketing. So. I hope I'm not leaving you too overwhelmed, but instead you've gotten a few ideas about how to make your organization or business a force for good in the world, for yourself, for your colleagues, for your competitors. And if there's any way that I can serve you, feel free to get in touch. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Marianne. We do have a few more minutes, so if anyone wants to ask a question at this time, feel free to type that in. But Marianne, I know you just mentioned a lot of resources, but can you go into a bit more detail about different types of certification that you mentioned, especially B Corp?
Sure. I think, I don't know. I don't have a sense of how much people know about B Corps. But basically, the way they put it on their website is that they're excuse me, I just did a lot of talking, is that they are to business what fair trade is to coffee. And so it's a certification certification process that lets people know that you have a certain set of values. And so like Fair Trade, like the Rainforest Alliance, these are all certifications. So it means that they, as a business that has a certification, you adhere to a certain set of principles or values, and that that has been standardized through and approved through some kind of system. So in some cases, and I think that these all of these certifications are good, and I think that they set a certain standard, but in some cases, they may not work for you or your business or a certain business for different reasons. And in other cases, you actually may want to go beyond what that certification is. But B certification, basically the B stands for benefit. And it's for businesses who want to demonstrate that they meet a certain standard of social and environmental performance, transparency, and accountability. So it's almost like a hybrid between a classic for-profit business model and a not-for-profit business. And so it gives businesses the ability to not just be accountable to their stakeholders or investors, rather, and not just be looking at the next quarter of financials, but gives them permission, I put that in quotes, to look at their impact on a much larger scale, including environmental impact, but actually including all these different areas that we talked about today, including well-being of employees, including looking at supply chains, including relationship with other companies. And so I think an organization like the B Corp certification organization, they're looking at this integrated approach too, which is all the more reason why I think businesses ought to be taking an integrated approach to peace and community and sustainability. So I think if you can Google B Corp and take a look at it, they have a whole set of questions, guiding questions that can help you think about how to make your business more more sustainable for your employees, for the planet, for yourself. And I think it offers a really great set of guidelines. And I also think that nonprofits actually are going to start using B Corp, B certification a lot more because they're, I think nonprofits are getting more professionalized and it gives them an opportunity to make some money and to treat the people that they serve as clients and not just people that they serve. So I think it's a really interesting thing. Companies that are B Corps, kind of the big ones are Patagonia, Seventh Generation, Method, the cleaning products, Dansko Shoes, the Hub, which are collaborative workspaces. So I think it's definitely something to keep an eye open for, and perhaps to consider for some organizations.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, Marianne, you shared so much today. Thankfully, we have it recorded. Everyone can take a look at this presentation on our YouTube channel. I sent out the link in the chat area, as well as the link to Marianne's past webinar. And I hope you all will join us again. We're hosting a ton of sessions this fall. Our next one is on Tuesday, and we'll be discussing methods to improve decision-making with Michael Mobison. So, Marianne, thank you so much. Have a wonderful night in Mozambique, and everyone have a good rest of the day. Bye.
Thank you. Take care. Bye.